Hello, guys, and welcome to this discussion. Among the things that COVID-19 has affected Dali is agriculture, because they say that we need a farmer three times a day or even more. And I'm joined by Dennis Nyandaya, a senior agronomist working with farmers all over the country. And of course, Patricia Lagat, an agripreneur who is all over the place doing really amazing stuff when it comes to agribusiness. Welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So first things first, how is the situation wherever you are? How are you dealing with the situation that we are right now? Chief?
Ronald, the situation, looking at, we look at this, the COVID issue with regard to farmers in different perspectives, because to a great extent, it has affected a lot of things that farmers are doing. And to also another extent, it has also just put a different view for the people who didn't value farming on what farming really is.
Jeb Korir?
Okay, as someone who is working with mostly the horticultural value chain, I can say I've seen a lot of effects of what COVID has done, right from the production to farm management in terms of labor and so on, all the way to marketing and even value addition. So there is real and tangible effects that can be measured. Yes, COVID has really affected this value chain.
Now, again, seeing from the point of view of the effects that COVID-19 has had, How does that speak to the general the endeavor of every farmer to at the end of the day ensure that they get to make something out of their farms and sell produce and be able to get consumers buying their products? Dennis, I know you're a person you really work closely with the farmers when it comes to agronomy, advising them on this and that. So how has it been for how does that this generally speak to them needing to at least hit a bar when it comes to them getting fruits of their labor?
No, this situation has really affected the farmers in different ways, because you realize that farming, nobody knows everything about or in farming, and farmers learn every day. For them to maximize their production, they need to liaise with agronomists, they need to liaise with other farmers who are doing the same thing. And this involves either traveling and meeting these farmers, talking, and just understanding what really happens in the different parts. But you realize with all these restrictions, then and also the government directive that we really need to stay safe. So farmers cannot really interact, and then agronomists cannot actually also visit the farms and advise these farmers. So you realize that what has happened is the farmers who know much, who are well knowledgeable in the production journey, are holding on. But the ones who are started up or who are starting up in farming are actually having it hard. Some of them have taken up technology to get this information, but that small-scale farmer at home who really want to venture into a different crop or who had started venturing into a different crop cannot get this information in real time. So it has really affected the way farming is being done and the information flow. And also just we projecting that maybe it might also have an impact on the general production.
Yeah, and actually still on the part of production, yeah, that is at the beginning of these value chains, there are three things which I can add to that. There's the issue of labor. Guys are afraid of first of all showing up to work. And then in other places, I'm assuming, say, between two counties where there's one a lockdown and the other one doesn't have. Probably workers used to migrate from one place going to work in another place. Probably that has also affected labor availability. And then there's illness. We just hope we don't get to that point. Because at this moment, you see anyone falling ill, they get so scared. They don't go anywhere. So probably there's a laborer who was supposed to come to work. And then the wife started coughing. Do you think this person will come to work? No, they really get scared. So it has affected, it has impacted on labor. And then there's also the inputs availability. Like the other day, I ordered seeds. I had talked to Nyandaya about it. I wanted seeds for spring onions. They're only found in Amiran at the moment. I ordered, I've paid Amiran, but they've never gotten to me. This is the third day, because they're saying their transporters have a problem with transporting bits and pieces of stuff to other towns like Eldoret. So you see, that's a major issue. Logistics has been affected, so it has impacted on my production on this end. The nursery is ready, but I cannot get the seeds. And then there's also the issue, what Nyandaya has just said, peer-to-peer engagement. It's very hard for farmers to visit each other at this time to see who is doing what on their farm. So that's on the side of production, and I think it has been highly impacted. And then when you add the closely related management side of things, extension is a problem. I'm sure Nyandaya can attest to that. You cannot go out there and train farmers. Nobody's welcoming you, neither, you know, as in it's just we are at a deadlock. And even government offices are closed. So the so-called government extension service offices are not even there on the field. So farmers basically are doing things on their own. That's on the production side. Then maybe we'll talk about marketing and logistics, and then there's the processing, and then there's consumption also, which I believe is the farthest end of the value chain. So yeah, that's how I can contribute to that first part.
All right. Well, actually, that is well spot on. So I was speaking to several guys who are in this business and in this venture, and I was trying to imagine, for instance, a farmer, let's say, who used to grow these something like mushroom or maybe French beans, and maybe they used to supply like 500 kilos. Right now, the consumer, maybe whatever they're taking, maybe a supermarket or something, maybe they just require maybe half of that. Is that a challenge that we're looking at, and how can we ensure that? Because right now we're just hopeful that this virus is gonna flatten the curve. But how again should we, going forward, cushion ourselves? You know, from because I think that really farmers are really feeling the brunt of all this pandemic.
I think that is true, because it all boils down to how we plan our production journey. Because you realize that for the farmers with this lockdown of some counties and also the restriction and movement, whereby you find that for the farmer who maybe had aspired to supply his produce in a different county and is not able to supply, then it all calls for us as farmers and for all farmers to always work on their production journey and not just one target market, and to do a good survey of the market. So if currently most of the farmers cannot supply their target market, it doesn't mean that farmers within their region have stopped eating. So it only means that this has shown farmers that you really need to start with your locality. I have seen farmers who have really changed, and instead of supplying their market that was 200 kilometers away, they have localized their market and they're doing good. So it's about, why should you take your produce 200 kilometers away when the same can be consumed within that county? So it's about market, because people will say, in my county, I cannot get this market, but there's somebody else in another county supplying your county. So it's like a cross market, whereby you are saying your county does not consume the amount that you're producing, and you take to a different county, but another person in the county where you are taking is bringing to your county. So it's all about understanding the market. And once farmers understand the market, then we are able, or they're able also, to just change in a flick of a second and supply the same market that maybe they're overlooking. So it has affected the farmers who had not actually anticipated this, who were relying, or either they had contract with the supermarket, they had contract with some shops to supply, and currently they cannot access that. And all this is also boiling down on even the employment that the employees that were actually looking at these farms. So it's something that's going to affect so many things. But about supplying different consumers, it's about a market, and it's really shown something that farmers were overlooking: that where is the market for this produce? Where can I supply? So some have just realized that they can actually supply within their locality, and To a great extent, they cannot actually satisfy that market.
Yeah. Now, I think I'll also add something on that.
All right.
Consumption drives markets. I'll use three crops, or rather three products. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's start with lemons, and then there's milk, and there's onions. And then onions, there are two types. There's the bulb onions, and then there's spring onions. So let me start with, first of all, with COVID, people are very scared about their health. People want something that will, quote unquote, boost their immunity. Lemons were not that thing that used to move in the market very fast. At the moment, there is a very high demand of lemons. Some farmers, we even had, you know, those trees in Nyandaya, those ones that were just for them, they are harvesting and taking to the market because there is market for that. Like in Eldoret, I know farmers who had just grown lemons for themselves, suddenly they are supplying the main market from around here. While in the past, lemons used to come from as far as, I don't know, Uganda. But now we are seeing there is an increase. So there are some things which have the demand for has grown. Like lemons. Then another thing, Jeff, that
just a moment, just a moment. Product. Just a moment. There's something that is telling me the lagat network is bandwidth is low. Just a second. All right, I think we're good now. Just proceed.
Oh, okay. So okay, let me start with lemons. Lemons did not have such a high demand in the past because people used to take it as a luxury. But now with the threat of COVID, people want to, like, quote unquote, boost the immunity. So lemons have become very high in demand. So farmers from around with family orchards are now harvesting lemons and taking them to the market because there's a high demand. They're realizing suddenly, oh, so this thing can make money. And then we're now receiving calls of people saying, I'd like to grow lemons. I'd like to grow lemons. So show me how to grow lemons. Because you see now, a new crop, a new product in the market is now driving demand and even creating a new value chain. You know, people are seeing the value in it. Then I'll go to the second product. We have onions. Bulb onions were consumed at home. But bulb onions came from as far as Tanzania and Uganda. Those borders have been locked. There's an issue with logistics between these two countries. So what has happened? There's no supply at the moment from other countries, but then there's local supply of the same. But the local supply, again, is not adequate. But what we have locally that is very adequate is spring onions. Spring onions used to be consumed more by institutions, schools, and restaurants. But now, even at home, we buy spring onions from the market because that is what is available. So we are now shifting our tastes even to suit whatever is available in the market, as Nyandaya had indicated. And then finally, let me talk about milk. The hugest consumer of milk, by the way, is not even households. It's institutions. You know, those colleges, those universities, your chai break. That's where most of the milk in this country goes. But now these institutions are closed. Dairy farmers are suffering because where do we take our milk? So they've resorted. They've had to adjust. Farmers are a very resilient lot. They're not adjusting. They're delivering milk to people's doorsteps, like really forcing it down your throat. Yeah. So you can see with these COVID challenges, farmers are now adjusting. Consumers are adjusting. Everyone along the value chain is adjusting. And some people are even reducing on the production of other things. Others are increasing on the production of other things because it's all in response to this thing that we did not all anticipate. Yeah.
All right. Nice. I think, are we losing Dennis? Dennis?
I don't know.
Chief?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear, but we cannot see you.
Cannot see you.
I don't know why you cannot see me.
Allow camera or something. All right.
Yes, you can now see me.
There you appear.
You're going on a break.
You're going on a break.
Yeah,
I'm going on a break. Now,
all right. So
yes,
so I love what Jokulera has really said. Really, quite a keen eye on how all these things are unfolding right before us. So, each of you guys are very active on social media. Jokulera, I've seen you. What is the exact name? Selling produce from I don't know, an app or something. I've seen that. Dennis, mm-hmm. as well. I've seen you online. Elim. Giving all manner of information to farmers. I mean, is this a new approach to not even the sales, but I mean information consumption that we now have to check over the spaces that the internet has provided? Because we're right now, we see we're having this meeting, just we are geographically displaced in the country, Eldoret, Nandi, and Kibwezi. So is that a new approach that that is being taken, as you guys have been the front line of actually continuing to churn this information out and addressing as well the issue of marketers deployed through your app? Can you just say a moment about that? But let's just first go to Dennis.
Farmers need to adopt the current technological advancements just on how they're going to get information. Because currently you realize that we are able to serve our clients by talking to them and giving them these guides. And then we're having a session with the farmers. As much as you buy any inputs from us, then we have a session at least daily with you and take you through at least 10 minutes through the guide. You tell us what you've done and what you're experiencing in your farms. Then you're able to look at it through the photos that you can send and advise you accordingly. And also, just farmers also need to get this technology and also leverage on them to get the market. So on technology, it's something that farmers cannot do away with, given that what farmers have experienced. And some have started appreciating it, because initially some were overlooking it and saying we just want to do the traditional way of farming. But currently information flow, information, just the new changes in the industry, farmers need to adopt technology, and it's not going to change.
Is that why you are having the classes that you've been doing? We can see a whiteboard behind you.
Yes, we're having classes, and some of these classes are just majorly for the crop specific farmers that have taken some seeds from us. So we take them through a weekly program, and they tell us what the challenges they're experiencing, And you realize that we are coming in and giving these farmers not just specific information, but broad information that farmers sit down and choose what they want. So it's something that we are also trying to build up. And I know Jeff Corrib is also doing something on our end. So it's something that I've said. This COVID-19 has really opened the farmers' eyes. And at the same time, it has opened the eyes of those who are not farming. Because somebody said when everything started, people didn't run to buy cars, people ran to their farms. So it has actually shown even the people who are nearing retirement that they need to work on farming so that they can also go home and do something. Yeah. So it's something that has really opened eyes of a lot of people, not just farmers, but even the people who are not in the farming industry, to start appreciating what farmers do. And I think it has been an interesting thing to watch, just hoping that the pandemic doesn't affect the farms. And as much as we are waiting for this to end, once it ends, then we believe that farmers will come out of this trauma.
All right, Jeff Corrib.
Yeah. Yes.
So it's actually just almost sort of the same question with Dennis. I've seen you online. I've seen you on Facebook. There's an app where farmers can just order the produce that is taken to their doorstep. I mean, these are dynamism that is coming in the market that really we have to learn to be embracing as even now, hopefully that the virus would be wiped away.
Yes. What is happening now is, well, this was an app targeted for consumers because they're the ones who drive demand. But then also, farmers are, we've not really gone to that level whereby farmers can now log in and tell us what they have from where, because there's a challenge. We cannot order from one farmer. Say one consumer wants 3 bananas, 2 onions. We cannot link that to one farmer, you know, because there'll be a challenge of logistics. We cannot match farmer to consumer directly like that. So there's the issue of warehousing. We have to have an in-between. Someone has to aggregate these things from farmers and then start serving the orders. So specific people are ordering, you know? So that's the biggest challenge for us because, of course, it wasn't a business model. So what is already? Who normally like supply markets, the ones who supply supermarkets, the ones who supply groceries, we also go to those people to source and then supply it to our consumers because we cannot really complete the whole value chain. It will mean investing heavily in aggregation points, which was not in our agenda from the first place. But we're just trying to solve a problem from this end so that we drive the demand for this stuff. And we have identified a major shift from the use of bulb onions to spring onions because that is what is available at the moment since we don't have much from other places. So I think it's still work in progress. And COVID is giving a lot of people in this marketing value chains a chance to really understand what the consumer wants and in case of a challenge what really happens. So it's, I believe Kenya is now ripe for that kind of change, and that's where we're headed. We're going to embrace technology and make things happen soon, and I think the virtual space is really opening up.
Wow, indeed. Yeah True, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. One thing that is in each of our hearts is the fact that, you know, we need to flatten this curve and get our normal lives back. But of course, even as we talk about agriculture, I think we even should delve on some, you know, positive vibes around. Dennis, I think we are losing you. I just want to get something along the lines of what this situation has taught you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but Steve is coming back. All right. So Chief.
Yes, the correct can proceed.
All right. Oh, yeah. So I was saying, we need to, in as much as we are all, I know right now we are all hopeful to flatten the curve and get our normal lives back. But, you know, we have to have some positive vibes around. If there's one thing that all this situation has taught you, what is it?
I don't know. This situation has taught me a lot, and majorly on how information can be relayed to farmers and the challenges that farmers have when we are giving them this information. So one of the things that I've realized is the market is not limited. It's about how we approach the market, because I've seen farmers changing and still being able to manage their markets. So it's about being open-minded. So the situation has taught me that for farmers really need to be open-minded and just be in a position to change within a very short period. And then also on how we as agronomists are going to be just talking to farmers and engaging them. It's also taught me that we really need to embrace a lot of the upcoming technologies to see that these farmers, in case of anything, that there's not that disconnect between us and the farmers. So it's about the whole understanding, the whole journey, and being able to place ourselves in the right position so that in case of anything, the farmers do not actually maybe get into a mess.
All right, mm-hmm. All right. What has all this situation taught you? You know, you deal with that, especially attitude, Pale.
Okay. What COVID has taught me is that farmers are really one, first of all, they're very resilient. I mean, everyone else is complaining, but we are here to hear farmers really crying out and saying to Menyanyaswa, no. Even if there is a challenge with markets, these farmers have found ways to navigate around it. So I want to believe the spirit of entrepreneurship, or rather the spirit of agri-enterprise, is very much alive in farmers, and we are going to beat this. So that is one hopeful thing. Then the second thing that I've seen, farmers are open to embracing technology. People go to Nyandaya online to ask for information for very specific things that are happening on their farms. Things that in the past, if you remember Nyandaya when you started, people are saying, I'm not a digital farmer. Okay, there was a term they were using. Telephone farmers were looked down on. But now everyone is a telephone farmer. So meaning, it's time we embrace technology and we became quote-unquote telephone farmers, because a day is coming when you'll not be able to have that agronomist come to the ground. So what will you do? Die with your crops? No. So we're embracing technology and things that we used to look down on, we're beginning to really, you know, take up. And then the third thing that I've learned is that markets will always be there. No matter what situation, people will always have to eat. So farmers, let's not fear. Let's continue producing. The best you can do is diversify on the production, because markets will change, tastes will change over time. And also diversify on where to market. Don't focus on one area of market, because if that one fails, if there's no lorry to supply that particular market you've been targeting, then you'll be stuck. So think very fast. How can I satisfy the immediate market around me? I think that's what is really happening right now. And then finally, another thing that we have seen government is trying to do is they're trying to sensitize people. Okay, they have their own interventions of trying to give consumers food directly, but they realized they learned that that wasn't working. So what they're doing right now is they're trying to incentivize farmers to do more production and marketing. And I think if there's one thing that will push agribusiness in this country to the next frontier, it's COVID. Because now government is taking notes that kumbe, these farmers have been suffering, and these are challenges that are really facing them. So you're beginning to see initiatives from government trying to push farmers towards production, towards local consumption, towards local processing and value addition, you know. And that's a major thing that we are seeing post-COVID probably. And we hope if we can go with that momentum, then we have a very bright future as a country in terms of agriculture. You know, we cannot compete with the developing countries in terms of manufacturing, probably mining and other, you know, industry and so on. But Africa has a huge chance to compete on the agricultural front. And if it takes COVID to make us realize how much potential we have, so be it. And I think that will be a major lesson that will be for us as a farming community henceforth.
Mm-hmm. Wow, indeed, absolutely, yes, exactly. I think in a way, for sure, this has acted as an eye-opener, that indeed, there's something that needs to be done more. The fact that you've said the government of the day is on toes to ensure that, you know, with the operations within the all these facets of agriculture is everything is considered. So I was to come to just like sort of a tail end of this by asking each of you, you know, what does a post-COVID hold in terms of food systems and everything? So in regard to agronomy, your bit, and your career, supply chain, how does post-COVID, we're expecting it to unfold before us? Dennis?
That's post-COVID, what we expect? I hope your question is what we expect after this.
In relation to agriculture and which is your field?
Yes. I expect a lot of interest in farming. That is for sure. That I expect a lot of people to go back to farming, because most have realized that farming is not just what people used to think. That it's for the failures in maybe the academic, but people have realized that it all starts with the farmers. So I expect a lot of interest in farming, and at the same time, I expect a lot of farmers asking questions about some of the challenges that I have seen. So I expect to see farmers more active in farms, because they realize that they cannot satisfy the market and they just need to change. As at the same time, on a different note, this I was discussing with a colleague, but...
Okay, there'll be a renewed interest in agribusiness by people from all fields, which will bring up the issue, will really boost on agri-enterprise, because solutions for all facets of the value chain will be brought up. That is one. All these people will be fired, all these people will be laid off, they'll come with their skill to add value to agriculture. That's what I believe will happen. Then secondly, because we've realized we have handed our sovereignty in terms of food security to two different countries for a long time, it has hit us that we need to do more as a country for ourselves. So food security will be a major discussion after this. And farmers will realize for us to have food, even in the worst of times, we need to start producing on our own. And probably there'll be an inter-county, inter-regional kind of integration whereby we say this county is very good with tomatoes, this one is very good with this. So we start, you know, zoning for the purposes of producing for the country all year round, instead of us depending on places like Tanzania and Uganda for this and that, you know. We cannot hand over, the way we cannot have a military from another country protecting us, we cannot hand over the duty of food security to another country. Yeah. So I think post-COVID, that will be a very important discussion too. And then last, there'll be two things. There'll be change of tastes. We're beginning to embrace what we had left, you know. Foods that will boost our immunity. We don't know when the next virus will strike us. So the fruits we had abandoned, indigenous, this and that, people will go back. Like now, managu is flying off the shelves. Lemons are flying off the shelves. Garlic is flying off the shelves. Ginger and so on. Honey. You know, those things we had abandoned that we used to look at as luxury, now they're becoming mainstream. And then there are things we've been denied for long that we'll get used to not having, you know. Because people are now preferring sweet potato to bread. We'll see people growing more sweet potato than going to processed bread, you know. Tastes will change. And then importantly, of course, I cannot stop by, you know, without adding this. Tech will be a very important aspect of all this. It's affecting all our lives in all facets, including agriculture. And probably even post-COVID, these discussions like this will go on. We don't have to meet for a conference in Nairobi to discuss issues. Farmers will realize, I don't have to be in this place in a physical location to have things heard or things to be said. So I think those are the four major areas I can highlight post-COVID, what will happen with the business value chains. Yeah.
Oh, indeed, indeed. What a rich insight there and commentary as well. Chief, I think you guys right now just say your final thing. Final thing to whoever will be watching, be it Kenyans or Wakulima, just, yeah.
I think my final comment is to congratulate the farmers who are resilient, who have actually shown resilience, and just to ask everybody who is around any farmer to appreciate these farmers by buying anything that they are farming, so that we don't let the farmers get into losses just because we want to buy either from a different store that is far away from the location. And then just after this, I think we really need to sit down and have a discussion on how to support farmers. Because above all this, everybody has been asking, what if we have a lockdown? With the restriction, people have been asking, what will we eat? Actually, that has been the main question, what will we eat? So with that question, then after this pandemic, then we really need to carry that question over and see how we are going to work on that with respect to supporting the farmers. So what will we eat should now turn to what will we eat and what will we support the farmers so that we can get what we eat more.
Wow. Patricia.
Final thoughts?
Yeah.
Okay, after COVID, farmers need to come together and have conversations, because we suddenly realize we are in the front lines. You know, we are very much essential services. So there's a doctor here and there's a farmer here on the same plane, COVID. So even post-COVID, we need to realize we are very important people, and we need to change our attitude towards how we look at ourselves. That's why I came up with this whole thing of agritude. I think for me, agritude will be very, very important, because there's some people we need to and we change that attitude of looking at themselves like, you know, we are just as a by the way. No, farmers, you're not as a by the way. Second, for all these people who want to get into agribusiness, you need to get into it and get into it properly. Not just through hearsay and success stories. you need to come also and learn from the failure stories of farmers. And as Nyandaya keeps saying, and I know it's a recurrent theme with him, there'll be a lot of bad people trying to lead farmers into, or rather new farmers or aspiring farmers into bad investments. That's a major issue. And that's why farmers need to, or rather an aspiring farmer needs to go to people like Nyandaya and get the actual information and the right information for what is really happening. So that is where Elim Agroinfo comes in. And then finally, these young people who are trying to do agribusiness, they believe it will change their lives, but they don't know what to do about it. It starts with a change of attitude. Come to us at Agritude. We'll help you with that. And then finally, food security, very important. It's in our hands. It's not in the hands of other countries. So I hope post-COVID we'll be more serious as farmers and start producing for ourselves, for our nation. Yes.
Wow. Those are quite insightful commentaries you've given, guys, and I really could not be more thankful for you joining and coming on board this discussion. I think it's really something that will really be igniting something along what you just talked about going forward, now that agriculture being, as you said, an essential service right now. So I really want to say asanteni sana kwa maongezi haya. And I wish wherever you are, you continue staying safe.
So, thank you. Keeping safe.
All right, Chief. Kwaheri. Asante sana.
Thank you very much.